In part one, we read quite a bit from Psalm 51, where David is pouring out his heart to God. And he said that God wants truth in the inner parts. Well, now we're going to look at 1 John chapter 1 and the end of 1 and the beginning of chapter 2, because it echoes these same truths in Scripture written specifically for Christians today. So we go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. Oh, this is a winner. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. Would to God that that message were being declared more definitively by more Christian ministers. Because a lot of people teach that God gives you sickness to test you. God brings dark times into your lives because it's part of his overall plan. Somehow we don't understand it. No, no, no. Let's just keep reading. Verse 6, if we claim to have fellowship with him, fellowship, koinonia, means a full share. It means that we're in tune with him, so to speak. Yet we walk in darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. God and you have fellowship one with another if you choose to walk in the light. Now, we can say, oh, we're having fellowship with him, but it is our actions that determine that. Folks, reality is your friend. Look at people's actions. Look at your own actions and judge them according to the word of God. And then it says, the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, purifies us from all sin. Because we will sin, because we have a sin nature that will run rampant if we allow it to. That's why the next verse, verse 8, says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Ladies and gentlemen, or lady, or gentleman, or ute, or whomever, we need to have a healthy respect. And we're going to go to Romans chapter 7 in the final segment of this little mini-series here, part 3. We need to have a healthy respect for the sin that dwells in us. Because if we don't, and if we're not on the lookout for us, it'll kick our butt. Pardon me. You may think it just did. But it will kick us around. Okay? And we don't want that to happen. So it says, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. Not that there's no truth in you, but in regard to that particular aspect of life. You have not hidden. Thy word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you, says Psalm 119:11. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, because we're going to sin, so what do? We confess our sins. He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar. Because he just said, everybody sins. And his word has no place in our lives. Then the next chapter begins. We see a giant two there. We don't want to necessarily stop because it all fits together here. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin, because the choice is ours, and we can lessen the number of sins in our lives as we hide more and more of the Word of God in our heart and recognize that we don't want to sin against Jesus who died for us and gave his life for us. Then we begin to walk closer and closer with him. But if anybody does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He always stands up for you. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. Verse 3, We know that we have come to know him if we obey his command. Did you hear that? We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. That's saying basically what I just said. Look at your actions. Look at other people's actions. Now, we want to look at their words and our words too, but words can fool you sometimes, where actions are much easier to read. We know that we've come to know him if we obey his commands. Verse 4, the man who says, I know him, but does not do, that's action, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Doesn't mean there's no truth in him, but that particular aspect of truth that he is violating by his actions is not in him. Okay, these verses are so pertinent. This is all about walking in the light. When we put truth in the inner parts, we walk in the light. So, the man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. Verse 5, but if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. How do you mature? How do you grow? You continue to make the choice to obey. So there's a song called Love is Obeying God's Word. And that's pretty true. Love. He that has my commandments and keeps them, Jesus said, he it is who loves me. And I will love him, and my Father will love him, and we will manifest ourselves to him. I think it's John 14, 21. Now, that doesn't mean that God and Jesus don't love people who don't love them. It means that they can't manifest their love to people who do not obey them. Very simple, because we have free will. We don't have to obey God. So it says again in verse 5, if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Because we are not oblivious to whether or not we are obeying God. Now, once we know the word, like it says, don't steal, but work so you have in order to give. Now, don't tell me that you don't know whether or not you're stealing or whether or not you're working. Now, your boss might not know whether or not you're working, but you do, okay? And finally, verse 6 says, whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. Not that that means you have to perfectly walk and never sin like Jesus. The point is, if you say that you are walking in the light, if you say that you're in him, your life should exemplify that. Your behavior should be Christ-like. Love, joy, peace, patience, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, self-control, the fruit of the Spirit. Those are the kinds of things that our lives should exemplify. And in part 3, don't miss this one. Don't touch that dial. Anyway, part 3, we'll go to Romans chapter 7, and we'll see the dilemma that the Apostle Paul puts forth for every Christian. Because every Christian has a battle raging within him. Galatians 5 says, the flesh lusts against the spirit. And the spirit doesn't say, stop. No, the spirit lusts against the flesh. And we get to cast the deciding vote. And we want to vote for the Spirit of God. We want to vote for the Word of God. We want to choose to do what God says, so that we can be changed, we can be transformed from the inside out and be more and more like our wonderful Lord Jesus.